Welcome. In this session, we are going to talk about certain eyelid disorders which we could not include under the headings of the previous sessions on eyelid disorders. Trichiasis is acquired misdirection of eyelashes towards the ocular surface, but like normal cilia, they originate from the anterior lamella of the eyelid. Trichiasis results from scarring around the hair follicles, and trichiasis may be associated with entropion, that is, inward turning of the eyelid margin, or may occur alone. If trichiasis is associated with entropion, surgical correction of the entropion is indicated first. Otherwise, a number of modalities are available to remove tracheatic eyelashes. Following manual epilation, tracheatic lashes recur in 4 to 8 weeks, and the recurrence rate is highest compared to the other treatment modalities for removing tracheatic lashes. Broken eyelashes following manual epilation are often more irritating to the cornea than intact cilia. In electrolysis or radio frequency ablation, the needle of the device is passed through the base of the lash into the hair follicle, and the base of the hair follicle is cauterized and the cilia is then taken out. In this method, there may be damage to adjacent normal hair follicles. Cryotherapy is also a treatment option for removing tracheatic eyelashes, and it is indicated for segmental trichiasis. Segmental trichiasis is when a series of adjacent eyelashes are tracheatic. Cryotherapy for trichiasis is applied in a double freeze-thaw manner to the base of the cilia. In double freeze-thaw cryo, the target tissue is first frozen and then allowed to melt, and then refrozen and then again allowed to remelt. But cryotherapy may cause skin depigmentation and lid margin notching. Argon laser can be used to remove tracheatic eyelashes if tracheatic eyelashes are only few and isolated. But argon laser works only with dark colored hair. And full thickness eyelid resection is also a treatment option for segmental trichiasis. Eyelid retraction is superior displacement of the upper eyelid margin and/or inferior displacement of the lower eyelid margin, exposing the sclera between the limbus and the eyelid margin. It can be unilateral or bilateral and can lead to lag ophthalmos and exposure keratopathy. Thyroid ophthalmopathy is the most common cause of both upper and lower eyelid margin retraction, and it is characterized by temporal flare, that is, retraction is more in the lateral half of the eyelid margin. Retraction in thyroid ophthalmopathy can be primary or can be secondary to proptosis. Iatrogenic eyelid retraction can occur following vertical rectus recession or blepharoplasty. Eyelid retraction following vertical rectus recession occurs because of attachments between the superior rectus muscle and levator palpebris superioris muscle, or between the inferior rectus muscle and the capsulopalpebral fascia. So when the superior rectus is recessed, the LPS is pulled backwards, and when the inferior rectus is recessed, the capsulopalpebral fascia is pulled backwards, causing retraction of the respective eyelid margin. Following blepharoplasty, eyelid margin retraction can occur because of excessive skin dissection, middle lamellar or septal scarring, and horizontal eyelid laxity. And post-blepharoplasty, eyelid margin retraction is most commonly seen in the lower eyelid because blepharoplasty is most commonly done in the lower eyelid. Eyelid retraction can occur when an attempt is made to neutralize contralateral ptosis, and this is called pseudo-retraction. So in this photograph, we see a patient who has ptosis in the right upper eyelid because of myasthenia gravis, and in an attempt to lift this eyelid, there is pseudo-retraction of the left upper eyelid. Eyelid retraction can also occur with shallow orbits, and here the lower eyelid margin is most commonly retracted. Eyelid retraction can be found with perinod dorsal midbrain syndrome, where the eyelid retraction is called Collier's sign, and eyelid retraction can also be found in Cushing syndrome, carcinomatous infiltration of lid retractors, and as a congenital form, which is a rare entity. For mild eyelid retraction, which is expected to resolve spontaneously, lubricants are used to protect the cornea. And for severe retraction, surgical modalities are required. Unless exposure keratopathy cannot be managed conservatively, surgery should be deferred till there is stabilization of the position of the retracted eyelid. For upper eyelid retraction, the upper eyelid retractors need to be weakened, and this can be done with a recession of LPS and or Muller's muscle, a partial myotomy of LPS, excision of Muller's muscle, and for temporal flare, as found in thyroid ophthalmopathy, a small lateral tarsography can be done additionally. For lower eyelid retraction from scarring, anterior lamellar scarring can be managed with skin grafts, middle lamellar scarring can be tackled with spacers, and for posterior lamellar scarring, mucous membrane grafts can be used. Horizontal tightening of the eyelid may be required, but excessive tightening itself may predispose to retraction. Severe cases of lower eyelid retraction require spacer grafts between the lower lid retractors and the inferior border of the tarsus, and auricular cartilage, heart palate, or dermis fat can be used as spacers. Benign essential blepharospasm we have discussed in the section on neuro-ophthalmology. Floppy eyelid syndrome is characterized by a lax superior tarsus which everts easily, and symptoms of floppy eyelid syndrome include irritation, redness, and a mild mucus discharge which are usually worse after waking up from sleep. Signs of floppy eyelid syndrome include lash ptosis and papillary conjunctivitis. In lash ptosis, the lashes of the upper eyelid are directed anteriorly and inferiorly instead of being directed anteriorly and superiorly as they normally do. Floppy eyelid syndrome is characterized by a rubbery lax superior tarsus which everts most easily in its lateral aspect, as seen here in this diagram when the eyelid is pulled upwards towards the forehead. Associations of floppy eyelid syndrome are important, and they include sleeping in a prone position, obesity, sleep apnea, keratoconus, eyelid rubbing, and hyperglycemia. Mild cases of floppy eyelid syndrome can be treated with lubricants and with eyelid taping or eye shield at night. Severe cases of floppy eyelid syndrome require wedge resection and horizontal tightening of the upper eyelid. Dermatocalysis is a redundancy of the upper eyelid skin which may be associated with orbital fat prolapse. It occurs in middle-aged to elderly individuals, and it can be associated with a ptosis of the brow or a ptosis of the upper eyelid. Patients with dermatocalysis complain of brow ache, eyelashes in visual axis, and a superior visual field loss. Blepharocalysis has an appearance like dermatocalysis but is not involutional, and instead occurs in young patients, usually females. Blepharocalysis patients have recurrent episodes of idiopathic angioneurotic edema leading to inflammatory edema of periorbital tissues. Several such episodes lead to thinning and wrinkling of the eyelid skin, and thus the appearance becomes like dermatocalysis. Recurrent episodes of inflammatory edema may be associated with orbital fat atrophy, aponeurotic ptosis, prolapse of the orbital lobe of the lacrimal gland, and prominent vascularity of the eyelid skin. And surgical repair of the thin and wrinkled skin in blepharocalysis may incite further episodes of inflammation leading to recurrence of the problem. Causes of eyelid edema are important to remember and include insect bite, allergy, cardiovascular and renal diseases, thyroid eye disease, CSF leakage, and lymphedema following lymph node dissection in the neck. In eyelid imbrication, a lax upper eyelid with a firm tarsus overrides the lower eyelid margin during blinking, and this results in conjunctivitis from mechanical rubbing. Mild cases of eyelid imbrication require lubricating agents, but severe cases require horizontal lid tightening of the upper eyelid. Trichotillomania is a habitual pulling out of eyelashes and eyebrow hairs, and is usually found in teenage girls. On examination, we find that some lashes appear absent and other lashes appear to be of different lengths, and these patients require psychiatric counseling. Thank you for listening.